So why dermatology? Because when I was in medical school in fifth year, that's where you take this subject, I saw all these patients and I just had no idea how one can figure out what kind of disease this is. So dermatology seemed to me the most interesting field and the most challenging one, contrary to general belief. And I was lucky to get into a clinic where there were professors who were very much interested and still are, this is the present professor and chairman of our clinic, in research. And so I studied skin diseases, and after a while, a long time after, I sort of were able to tell what disease is what by just looking at the skin of the people. We already learned that the skin is the largest barrier organ, and it has many, many different functions. Lately, I would point to you the skin immune system as a huge barrier organ. It relates to our immune system very much. And if you go into skin research, you will end up in immunology very, very soon. And immunology is really another very interesting field, and you will see that its advance really helped therapy in many diseases. And this is something that we never think about, but the skin is also very important in the cognitive, psychological, social, emotional development of a human being. Another interesting thing about the skin is that it is the epidermis, the outermost layer of the skin, is a self-renewing tissue like the bone marrow. So the keratinocytes, those cells, the skin cells that are called keratinocytes, make up the outer layer of the skin, and they have a very specific continuous proliferation, differentiation, and renewal. And also another important thing, as far as dermatology is concerned, is that it is a very easily accessible organ. You can take skin biopsies from patients easily. This is a small device called punch biopsy device, and you can take a small sample. The patient, they don't really mind that. It doesn't cause pain, and you can have histopathology. So dermatopathology is a large part of our field, and it helps a great deal in understanding diseases. And I started psoriasis research in the US when I happened to get there, by chance actually. And psoriasis is an intriguing disease. You can see how the skin is inflamed in certain spots, and then very sharp-edged lesions. We call these inflammatory changes lesions, and the normal-looking skin in between those lesional skin are called non-lesional skin. They look normal. Now the disease, just as a medical student goes through certain evolution before he or she understands what disease is what, the science is the same. It was only von Hebra, very famous Austrian dermatologist, who described psoriasis as a distinct entity. Robert Willen, a British dermatologist, still called it lepra. This is how we learn. And this was an extremely important step in dermatology, actually, although it doesn't seem such a big deal now. Another person who described the peculiar thing about this disease is Koebner, who described in this disease the phenomenon that these people have, that they respond to all sorts of injury that is put on their skin with very similar lesions, with the psoriatic lesions. So normal people would not have this kind of change in their skin through injuries. We now know that psoriasis is a multigenic, multifactorial disease, and therefore it is a very complex disease. And another fact is that in psoriatic skin, in those lesional skin, the keratinocytes are hyperproliferative. This Ki-67 marker marks those cells that are proliferating in the skin. And also, there is, aside the hyperproliferation, there is abnormal differentiation, and the skin becomes so thick, and also neutrophils and T lymphocytes inflame the skin. They even get into the epidermal part. That the immunology and the inflammation, the T lymphocyte inflammation, infiltration was an important feature in the skin lesion was only described in 83. And then in 86, some people noticed that an agent that blocks T cell activation improves psoriasis. We were working on this field, and we found that indeed these T cells may act on keratinocyte stem cells, and they induce these cells to hyperproliferate. And at the time when I was working on these things, already in the lab started some work with a fusion protein that was supposed to block the seed. This T-cell activation, and in fact, the what now called those monoclonal antibodies or biologicals that are targeted to very specific points on specific immune cells are in very much used, not only in dermatology or in this particular disease, psoriasis, but in many other fields. Now, this first biological that was used in psoriasis that blocked this T-cell activation, in fact, the drug was put on the market in 2003, and in 2011 it was already withdrawn, such as another drug that was also put on the market, and it has been already withdrawn because some side effects that later appeared. You have to understand that there is always a chance that something will turn out not as expected, but it seems that these biological targeted therapies are very well working. In fact, surprisingly, they have little side effects, the ones that we can use nowadays. And this slide just shows you how in this particular disease, psoriasis, we had from 2004, between 2004 and 2008, some agents, biologicals, that we still use, and then how fast new drugs came on the market that are better for the purpose. They are more effective, and they have their side effects are really not very important, so they can be used easily. One has to be very cautious. I also have to tell you that these drugs are only symptomatic therapies. They don't treat the disease, and that's where we are still working on how to make better understand the complexity of the disease, and we focus on the non-lesional skin of the patients, because we have from the old data, we know that the keratinocytes of the patients are not behaving in in vitro cultures and in vivo. They don't behave as normal cells. And we have some data. I don't want to go into particular details here. And later, as we go and investigate more and more the non-lesional skin of these people, we find more and more interesting differences that really differentiate the normal-looking skin of these patients from the healthy people's skin, which they look, by looking at them, they are similar. So we have all sorts of data showing that these keratinocytes are different, and also we have data showing that the fibroblasts are also different in these people. And one of the in the lab, there are of course many people working on psoriasis and also on other topics, and each group has a particular way to look at these differences. There, some of them are using now the new techniques that are giving them many big data, high throughput analysis, proteomics, and so they will probably get some interesting results, but there are still some of us working on a preformed hypothesis, and of course we all work together. We know now that even the extracellular matrix and the basement membrane component of the skin is in the non-lesional skin different than in the normal skin and the lesional skin. So this is a cartoon that shows some of the aspects that we have discovered lately in terms of the non-lesional skin, which we believe, and we have data proving, that has an unstable structure. And hopefully, learning more about these particulars may help us to do better therapies. I also have to mention that if you are a clinician and you work in the clinic as well as in research, you have to, I show you some pictures that we deal with patients. You are also obliged to do clinical research. You have to put your clinical experiences into papers, because that is the only way that your colleagues will be able to learn from your experience. And that's what medicine is about. That's how it becomes a science and not just something else. Thank you.